it's finally happened. You've moved out. You're on your own. Congratulations. But everyone still needs a little help sometimes.
Mom, have you seen my wallet?
It's in your back pocket.
No, I checked there.
Your other back pocket, dear.
Thanks, Mom.
Introducing the Mom Personal Assistant, the only smart speaker device with all the wisdom, caring, and sage advice of a mother.
Mom, please call Brad.
Honey, I'm just not sure he's right for you.
Just call him.
Okay, calling Ryan.
No, Mom, I said call Brad.
Trust me.
The Mom PA always has your best interests in mind.
Wish me luck, Mom. Big interview today.
Did you eat breakfast? Is that what you're wearing?
Wait, what?
Did you even shower?
She's there to provide a helping hand whenever you need it.
Mom, set a timer for 40 minutes. Mom?
The Mom Personal Assistant won't function until you say the magic word.
Oh, right. Mom, please set a timer for 40 minutes.
Sure thing, hun, but it's only 30 minutes for that dish.
The Mom PA is always correct and basically knows everything.
Mom, what setting should I use for this laundry?
Mom, do you think I should color my hair?
Hey, Mom, can you please order mac and cheese?
You still have two boxes.
What? No, we're out.
Did you look?
Yeah, I just looked. It's gone.
Do you want me to look?
No, it's okay. I'll go look again.
Try looking with your eyes this time.
Based on God's perfect design, the Mom Personal Assistant is thoughtful, kind, encouraging, and supportive.
You are beautiful. It's okay. You're gonna get through this. I am so proud of you. You can change the world. But right now, hon, you really need to change your socks because they smell like a dumpster.
Ugh, Mom.
The Mom Personal Assistant. Always helpful, always reliable, and always there for you.
Happy Mother's Day. I hope you enjoyed that humorous video. Yeah, it was humorous, but there was a lot of truth in that video. Our mothers care for us in more ways than we probably imagine. And they care about every aspect of our lives, and that's a good thing. We all need someone to look after us, to care for us. Well, welcome to Rising Hope United Methodist Mission Church on this Mother's Day, May 9th, 2021. My name is Kerry Kincannon, and I'm one of your pastors here. You know, when I was a child, what I remember about Mother's Day was that Mom would get me dressed up in my little suit or sport coat and bow tie, and she would then rush Dad, me, and my brother and sister off to church. And you know, what I remember most about Mother's Day was that the fact that the women got carnations that day. Women whose mothers had deceased received a white carnation. Women whose mothers were still alive got a pink or a red carnation. And we do that here at Rising Hope. You know, I've tried to carry on that tradition. I think it's good to honor the women and the role that they have played in our lives and the care that they have for us. But I think there's a deeper meaning that we can put to Mother's Day that even has been a part of our traditions than simply passing out carnations and having a big, wonderful meal after church. I think about the women in the Bible, and I think about how women were the first witnesses to the resurrection. Women were the first to get the gospel, to understand what the gospel is all about. And even Jesus, when he was hanging on the cross, wanted to make sure that his mother was taken care of. And then I look at American history and the history of Mother's Day in America, and you look back and Julia Ward Howe, she wrote the lyrics to the Battle Hymn of the Republic. And in 1870, she wrote a Mother's Day proclamation. And this Mother's Day proclamation was an attempt to begin to build a peace movement with mothers at the forefront of this peace movement and leading it. And in this proclamation, she says that she hopes that women never, ever again have to welcome their husbands and sons home from the carnage of war. She said that she wanted she wanted people in the United States, she wanted everyone to have the imprint of God in their lives and not the imprint of Caesar. These are her words. Then I think of Anna Jarvis, who also had a lot to do with our current celebration of Mother's Day. Anna Jarvis happened to be a Methodist laywoman. And she, back more than 100 years ago, was continuing to try to build on the work that Julia Ward Howe had done. And she was trying to create friendship groups among women to help our nation that was still divided over the Civil War, to try to help our nation begin to heal some of the divisions and come together. And she really was focused on trying to help us as a nation reflect God's love to one another. And then I think of the language of Mary, the mother of Jesus. You read in Mary's song or the Magnificat, you read her words, and her words have such deep, profound meaning. They reflect the depth of the gospel, where the powerful will be dethroned and the hungry will be filled. And I start to think about how can we in the church really begin to reflect some of the original meaning of what Mother's Day was. How can we really reflect women in our lives, the importance that they have had in helping us really understand what the gospel is all about and how they have nurtured us in faith? How can they help us with in the church? How can we take Mother's Day in the church and use it as a way to really get into understanding of redemption and reconciliation and coming together? You know, our mothers look out for us. God really is looking out for us. How can we build this celebration of Mother's Day so we're talking about how we can come together and reflect the gospel and live out of the depths of the gospel and use Mother's Day as a celebration of not only the women who are in our lives, but how those women have helped us live the gospel. What would it take for a fresh wind of the Spirit to blow upon us in Mother's Day and really get that imprint of Christ into our lives? Well, I want to move on with worship, but I want to move on with this prayer for the women in our lives. For our mothers who have given us life and love, that we may show them reverence and love, we pray to the Lord. For mothers who have lost a child through death, that their faith may give them hope, that their family and friends support them and console them, we pray to the Lord. For women, though without children of their own, who like mothers have nurtured and cared for us, we pray to the Lord. For mothers who have been unable to be a source of strength, who have not responded to their children and have not sustained their families, we pray to the Lord. Loving God, as a mother gives life and nourishment to her children, so you watch over your church. Bless these women, that they may be strengthened as Christian mothers. Let the example of their faith and love and that of Julia Ward Howe and Anna Jarvis shine forth. Grant that we, their sons and daughters, may honor them always with a spirit of profound respect. Grant this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. One more thing. Judy, mother of our daughter Caitlin, the love of my life, I want to thank you for all the ways that you help me understand God's love in a deeper way and what that means. I'm bringing these carnations home to you.
Lord, yes, Lord. as the Lord, He first loved me. I will look to the hills, from which cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord. I love the Lord because He first loved me.
A member of Rising Hope. And I've been with this church maybe like 6 or 7 years, and everybody's here is so good. And I just thank Pastor Karen and Pastor Wild and God, thank you. I'm reading from Isaiah 66, verse 7 through 9. Common English Bible. Before she was in labor, she gave birth. Before she sprang, came upon her. She delivered a boy. Whoever heard such a thing, whoever saw such a thing as these, can a land come to birth in one day? Can a nation be born all at once? Yet as soon as birth, spring came, Zion bore her children. Will I open the womb and not bring to birth, say the Lord? Will I, who created life, close the womb, say your God? The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Good morning, Rising Hope. It's such a joy today to introduce to you our guest preacher. Her name is Alyssa Densham. Alyssa is the family and children's coordinator at Kingstown Communion, a United Methodist church. Over the last several weeks, I've had the opportunity to fill in for their pastor, the Reverend Michelle Matthews, as she's on maternity leave. And Alyssa and I have been working very closely together in coordinating worship for Kingstown, but also a sermon series that I've been doing with both Rising Hope and Kingstown Communion entitled Ordinary Encounters with an Extraordinary God. Today, I'm excited to share Alyssa with all of you as she talks about birthing babies. May you be blessed as you hear these words today, and may we encounter the mothering God who cares and nurtures us all.
I love birth. If you've spent any amount of time around me, you probably know that I teach birth education classes, and you might even know that I've trained as a doula. To me, you see, birth is this really incredible, insanely powerful, and yet ordinary event that happens in the course of pretty normal lives, and well, I love it. For this reason, I love birth stories, and for this reason, I really love my own birth stories. If you're my friend on Facebook, you will see in the days leading up to my kids' birthdays that I recount their birth stories. In March, I tell Keegan's story. And as far as birth stories go, it's relatively uneventful. a pretty ordinary story, really. I mean, to me, of course, it's extraordinary, but it's not that different from so many other birth stories out there. But in April, I tell Coraline's birth story, and it is probably my favorite birth story ever. I mean, of course, I am a little bit biased, but it really is such a good story. I mean, even though it was in the making for 41 weeks and 5 days, it really just spans from 11 p.m. at night to 1:38 in the morning. In 2.5 hours, I went from not in labor to having a baby in my arms. And it all happened between Fort Belvoir and the exit for Braddock Road off of the Fairfax County Parkway. After being nearly 2 weeks past her expected due date, Coraline Fay decided she was done waiting. And at 1:38 in the morning, on the shoulder of the Fairfax County Parkway, in the back of our salsa red Toyota Sienna minivan, I gave birth to a 12-pound baby. I mean, I love this story. For one, it completely sums up our entire life with our now 3-year-old. But it also has this really awesome shock value, right? I mean, 12 pounds, shoulder of the parkway, salsa red Toyota Sienna minivan. You have to admit, right? It's a story with a little bit of pizzazz. And because of that, I have told it many, many, many times in a variety of spaces. And without fail, I can always expect that the first question people ask, I mean, after the shock has worn off, is, but who delivered her? The answer, of course, is me. I delivered her. I worked hard for that birth. John, my husband, caught Coraline as midwife to this birth, but I, in fact, delivered her. This answer confuses some people, and I know that it will, because in truth, we have a pretty skewed understanding of birth in this country. Well, in most countries, really. You see, even though birth is an example of an extraordinary yet ordinary event, we sometimes get so lost in the extraordinariness of it, we forget how ordinary it really is. Birth is, it's not new. It's not even something that only humans do. Birth is something that happens across creation in a variety of really neat ways. But as we humans moved away from our small communities and into urban and then peri-urban, suburban landscapes and lifestyles, we sort of moved away from the really ordinariness of birth. When babies are born today in the United States, they are generally born in hospitals, where doctors dressed in sterile PPE swoop in after being called by nurses at the last minute, in after hours of labor by the birthing person, supported by amazing nurses and partners and doulas, we give credit of the delivery to the doctor. It's just this thing we do. But that's not all birth in the United States. Some births are attended by midwives, and those births are, well, they're really just different. The midwifery model of birth is holistic. It sees a birthing person as more than just fundal height or cervical dilation. at prenatal appointments that might last an hour or more, a midwife will pull out a Doppler, but she'll also spend most of the appointment talking to you about your hopes and your fears and really often just your everyday life. By the time birth happens, your midwife knows you and you know your midwife, and it feels like you're being supported by family. On the day of Coraline's rapid descent, I had just sat with my midwives hours earlier. At 41 weeks and 5 days and in the state of Virginia, I was 24 hours away from being required to transfer care to a physician I didn't know. I had literally tried almost everything I could to make this stubborn baby girl come, and true to her stubborn form, she had refused. I did not want a birth experience that didn't include my midwives. I was scared and I was grieving. That day though, the midwives, they didn't tell me to buck up, to stop worrying, that all that matters was a healthy baby and a healthy mom. Actually, they didn't tell me anything. Instead, Mayanne and Nancy, they just sat on that bed and held me, knowing that all I needed was the comfort of their presence. That's the thing, you see. Midwives just know because they've taken the time to really see you. In one of my favorite birth videos that I use in classes, a woman is laboring in a birthing pool, and she looks up and she asks, "How much longer?" And the midwife, quietly off camera and in the background, calmly responds, "As long as it takes." In the afterbirth interview, the woman tells us that she knew that her midwives were there not because they were in her line of sight, but because every now and then she would hear one say, "You are doing perfectly well." I know that feeling. In Keegan's birth, every now and again, I remember my doula, Megan, quietly saying, "Good sounds," or "You're doing exactly what you should be doing." There's something really wonderful about that kind of gentle, intentional, knowledgeable support that just washes over you like a bath of love. For midwives, you see, birth is extraordinary because it's new life emerging into the world. And yet it's also incredibly ordinary. Because when allowed to proceed in its own way and in its own time, it's rarely eventful, except for how it makes us part of all of creation. It's Mother's Day today, and I am so grateful for what my midwives have taught me about the extraordinary ordinariness of birth. And I sometimes think that really, our midwives are teaching us more than just that. They're teaching us how to meet God. In Isaiah 66, verses 7 through 9, the Lord tells us of a truly extraordinary, unordinary birth. God says, "Before she was in labor, she gave birth. Before her pain came upon her, she delivered a son. Who has heard of such things? Who has seen such things?" I mean, truly, right? Who has heard of such a thing? I mean, Coraline was a fast labor. 2.5 hours, it is not normal. You could almost say that, as in verse 8, as soon as I was in labor, I delivered Coraline. Now, precipitous labor, though, it's a variation of labor. It's not normal, but it's also not abnormal either. And I can very much vouch, though, for the fact that a fast labor does not mean that it was an easy labor. Almost as soon as I was in labor with her, I was in transition, and my contractions just stacked on top of each other with no time in between to rest. In Isaiah, though, Zion delivered her baby before she was in labor. Zion gave birth before she experienced the pain of labor. And no one has seen such things. No one had ever seen such things. In Genesis 3, as punishment for her sin, God tells the woman that God will greatly increase her pangs in childbearing. God says, "In pain you shall bring forth children." This is the way of birth that birthing persons have known since time immemorial. Childbirth is work. It's hard work. It's why we call it labor. And yet, here in Isaiah, God is talking about a different kind of birth. This isn't the normal way of creation. God is doing something different here. God is bringing forth new life. In verse 8, Zion is delivering her children painlessly. It's a powerful image, and it's designed to shock us into paying attention. And we need to pay attention, because in verse 9, the image shifts. God asks, "Shall I, the one who delivers, shut the womb?" God becomes the birthing person. Have you ever considered God in the labor of childbirth? But Isaiah 66 isn't the first time that we find this image, actually. In Isaiah 42, verse 14, God says, "For a long time I have held my peace, and I have kept still and restrained myself. Now I will cry out like a woman in labor. I will gasp and pant." In Isaiah, God is laboring. God is getting ready to birth something. In verse 42:9, God tells us that the old things are gone, they have passed away, and now new things I declare. A few verses later, God tells us how those new things will come into being. God is birthing them like a person birthing a child, actively bringing something into being, sounding out their labor through their breath, and through their breath, bringing new life into being. If you look all around you, you can see God birthing new life. Just the other day, as I was driving down Telegraph, I realized how green everything is now. Just a few short weeks ago, those leaves were just tiny buds waiting to appear. And now, here they are, these bright green leafy leaves. It's new life birthed into being. I've also noticed an uptick in the number of baby animals, the birds, the foxes, the fawns. Soon, we'll see the newly hatched goslings as they shut down Telegraph with their parades from the Coast Guard station to the pond that's just across the way. It's new life, birthed into being. And I cannot tell you how overwhelmed I am by all of the new babies. In John's office, in the last 15 months, 17 new babies have been born. And as sort of a pastor of some sort, I get the distinct privilege of knowing of a few babies who are on the way here in our own community. New life, birthed into being. But none of these things, not the flowers, not the goslings, not the new babies, are outside of what are perfectly normal life cycles. Birth is, on the whole, pretty ordinary. And yet, each time, each birth is also perfectly extraordinary, made so because of God working in this world. Sometimes, though, we forget that it's God doing the laboring. It's God doing the work. God is the one delivering new life. We run around, intervention happy, hooking a laboring God up to continuous monitoring and demanding that God tell us God's pain on a scale from 1 to 10. We rush from one birth to the next, trying to make it just in time to deliver the new life, never quite getting there. And when the babies arrive in call, caught by a grandma or a spouse, we mutter about the nurses not letting us know with enough notice. We expect that we're the ones delivering what God is birthing. And we're so caught up in the task at hand that we don't see the miracle that just happened before us. But here's the thing. Doctors don't deliver babies. Birthing people do. And midwives know this intuitively. They might be ready to catch the new creation. They might even have to hook their index fingers under creation's arms and give it a little twist and a tug when the birth process stalls just a little bit. But for the most part, midwives take a watchful, waiting approach to birth. They know that if they don't interfere, if they provide the birthing person with support that resonates with that person in that space at that time, then the ordinariness of birth will play out into something truly extraordinary. God does not need us to deliver God's new creation. God wants us to support God's labor through affirmation of all that God is doing. God wants us to be ready should anything not be quite right with this particular birth. God wants us there, ready to catch that slippery neonate. But God does not need us to deliver God's new creation, especially when that new creation is us. You are God's new creation. God is working in you to make you new again. In baptism, you were born again and made new, and each day, with every prayer you say, with every verse you know, every time you take the bread and the juice in Holy Communion through God's grace, God's Spirit is transforming you so that you can be more conformed to the image of the one who made you. The elements of bread and juice are pretty ordinary. Our prayers are pretty ordinary. Even the water of baptism is pretty ordinary until God transforms them. The power of the Holy Spirit transforms these ordinary things and allows us to encounter in them the living God so that they become truly extraordinary, like birth. The ordinary event in the cycle of life. Birth becomes a place where we encounter God in the miracle of new birth that transforms all that is ordinary into something truly, truly extraordinary. God does not need us to deliver God's new creation. God needs us to be midwives, aware of the ordinariness and waiting in that ordinariness for that which will be truly extraordinary. I love birth stories, and I cannot wait to hear the story of how God birthed you into new creation. I offer this to you in the name of the God who births us all, the Son who was birthed by a woman named Mary, and the Spirit who constantly births us into new life. Amen.
Apart. So remember.
This is the time we share our tithes and offerings, or like we like to call it here at Rising Hope, giving back to God. You know, we have been so blessed by so many great mercies, and this is a time where we say to God, we want to work with you in your mission in this world. You know, put us to doing, put us to giving, help us move your kingdom forward. And one of the ways we can do that is by sharing the love of God with the hungry, the homeless, the thirsty, the naked, the blind, the sick and the imprisoned. Rising Hope is here on the Route 1 corridor to share God's love in all of these ways that we can, recognizing that God cares about the whole person, not just whether we are spiritually right with God, but whether we have food, clothes, shelter, a safe environment. So I invite you to join Rising Hope in our mission to further God's kingdom in this world. You can make a donation to us at www.risinghopeumc.org/donate, or you can mail us a check at Rising Hope Mission Church, 8220 Russell Road, Alexandria, Virginia, 22309. All of your donations will go towards furthering God's kingdom in this world. If you don't have the financial resources, then I ask you to make this moment a moment of your dedicating your life to God, dedicating your life to living out the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Praise be the nurses and doctors, every medical staff bent over flesh to offer care, for lives saved and lives lost, for showing up either way. Praise for the farmers tilling soil, planting seeds so food can grow, an act of hope if ever there was. Praise be the janitors and garbage collectors, the grocery store clerks and the truck drivers barreling through long, quiet nights. Give thanks for bus drivers, delivery persons, postal workers, and all those keeping an eye on water, gas, and electricity. Blessings on our leaders making hard choices for the common good, offering words of assurance. Celebrate the scientists working a way to understand the thing that plagues us, to find an antidote, and all the medicine makers. Praise be the journalists keeping us informed. Praise be the teachers, finding new ways to educate children from afar, and blessings on parents holding it together for them. Blessed are the elderly and those with weakened immune systems, all those who worry for their health. Praise for those who stay at home to protect them. Blessed are the domestic violence victims on lockdown with abusers, the homeless and refugees.
Praise for the artists and poets, the singers and storytellers, all those who nourish with words and sound and color. Blessed are the ministers and therapists of every kind, bringing words of comfort. Blessed are the ones whose jobs are lasts, who have no savings, who feel fear of the unknown gnawing. Blessed are those in grief, especially who mourn alone. Blessed are those who have passed into the great night. Praise for police and firefighters, paramedics, and all who work to keep us safe. Praise for all the workers and caregivers of every kind. Praise for the sound of notifications, messages from friends reaching across the distance. Give thanks for laughter and kindness. Praise be our four-footed companions with no forethought or anxiety, responding only in love. Praise for the seas and rivers, forests and stones who teach us to endure. Give thanks for your ancestors, for the wars and plagues they endured and survived. Their resilience is in your bones, your blood. Blessed is the water that flows over our hands and the soap that helps keep them clean each time a baptism. Praise every moment of stillness and silence so new voices can be heard. Praise the chance at slowness. Praise be the birds who continue to sing the sky awake each day. Praise for the primrose poking yellow petals from dark earth. Blessed is the air clearing overhead so one day we can breathe deeply again. And when this has passed, may we say that love spread more quickly than any virus ever could. May we say this was not just an ending, but also a place to begin.
A couple of quick announcements. We invite you to join us for our Zoom coffee hour immediately following the service or at 12 noon, whichever one is later, because sometimes our service runs over. You can see the telephone call-in link on the screen. But if you want to join us by Zoom with a video, you can call the office and get the video connection sent to you so you can make that happen. I want to remind you, those of you who have been a part of our Wednesday night Bible study know we took a break for a couple of weeks. We are going to begin Bible study up again this Wednesday, May 12th. And I am really excited to say that we are beginning to move back into trying a little bit of in-person connections here at Rising Hope. So Wednesday, May 12th, We are going to have an in-person Bible study that will also have the ability for you to do the Zoom link and connect in with us at those of us who are here in person. We're requesting only those who have been vaccinated. Only those who have been vaccinated can come to this in-person Bible study. Others, you can join us on the Zoom link. We're going to do a four-week study that Pastor Cameron is going to be leading, and I think it's going to be a really good time of getting back together with one another. We'll be socially distanced and, for the most part, wearing our masks during this time, even though we're requiring you to be vaccinated. The other thing is to remind you that next Sunday, Kingstown Communion will be here again with a Sunday supper at 3 p.m. They'll be giving them out at the front door. And if you've partaken in one of their meals before, you know their meals are fantastic. They have a cook at Kingstown Communion who happens to be a Pentagon chef, so you know he knows how to cook. And that's why the meals have been so good. So if you have any prayer concerns, please call 703-360-1976 and speak with Vanessa McCormick. She is our prayer warrior. She'll pray with you. Or if you want one of the pastors to pray directly with you, she will pass that information on and we will return your phone call.
My dreams are gone.
Friends, it's so good to be sharing in table fellowship with all of you this day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Would you join me in our liturgy for the Great Thanksgiving? The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. And let us give thanks to the Lord our God, for it is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right, a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, creator of heaven and of earth. You are the one God above all gods, in whom we live and move and have our being. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. He is in you, and you are in him. And through him, we know you, and we are blessed. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he was to give himself up for us, he took bread. He lifted it and he gave thanks to you. He took the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat from this, all of you. For this is my body, given for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins." And likewise, when the supper was over, he took the common cup, he lifted it, and he gave thanks to you. He took the cup and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, drink from this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. And as often as you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, do this in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died, Christ has risen, and Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us who are gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at the heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, both now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us join our lay leader, Shauna James, in our Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily prayed. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body. The bread over which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The body of Christ given for you. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. At this time, wherever you may be joining us from, we invite you to partake of your elements, your bread and your juice, and to taste and to see that the Lord is indeed good. Would you pray with me? Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Open us to receive the Spirit of truth and grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
This service has come to an end. But our service is just beginning. Remember to love unconditionally because that's how God loves you. And to include everyone in that love because the love of God in Jesus Christ excludes absolutely no one. And don't forget to celebrate life because it's God's grace that makes life worth celebrating. Remember, Jesus is the rock that rolls our blues away.